Good morning to all. Today we will be having a general presentation. The topic of today's discussion is the management of slipped capped femoral epiphysis. This is a study done at Southampton University Hospital in UK. It is done by NG Uglow and Clark, and it was published at British Editorial Society of Bone and Joint Surgery. This is the original article. Coming to the topic. The management of difficult cases of slipped capped femoral epiphysis is a controversy. Single corticocancellous cannulated screw is the operation of choice. The optimum time regarding treatment is uncertain on cases of unstable and severe slip. The delay in diagnosis will be associated with poor outcome. The absence of symptoms is the main cause for the delayed diagnosis. Sometimes the clinician can miss the findings. The incidence of this SCFE varies from 1 to 7 per 100,000 of the population. Coming to the etiology of the slipped capped femoral epiphysis, the true etiology remains uncertain still, but the endocrine abnormalities, especially the hypothyroidism and treatment with the growth hormones, are related to SCFE. Juvenile chronic arthritis and SCFE has been linked to the presence of HLA DR4 amidase association, but a study from Bahrain didn't show that this association. Neither was there an association with HLA B12.7. The treatment with GnRH agonist has also been associated with a higher incidence of SCFE. There is an association between retroversion of the neck of the femur and a reduced neck shaft angle. Advances in imaging software. Such knowledge is unlikely to affect the initial presentation, but can be used if prophylactic fixation of the opposite side is needed. Coming to the classification of SCFE, functionally the SCFE is classified into two according to the weight bearing, that is stable and unstable. Chronologically relating to the time of the onset of symptoms, and graphically depending on the degree of displacement as measured on radiographs. Lauder and co-workers has provided the most useful classification for clinical practice, that is describing the slip as either stable or unstable. The distinction between stable and unstable slip is the ability of the child to bear weight. An avascular necrosis develops in an unstable slip but very rarely in a stable slip. An acute state referred to a period of 3 weeks from the onset of symptoms, and a chronic state is defined as greater than 3 weeks of the onset of symptoms. An acute exacerbation with a longer background of symptoms is referred to as acute on chronic. This will again relate to the complication of avascular necrosis, which develops with a higher incidence in patients who have been defined as acute compared with a chronic group. The degree of displacement of the epiphysis on the femoral neck can be measured on plain radiographs. The differentiation of mild, moderate, and severe slips has been described by Southwick. The Southwick angle is defined as the difference between the head shaft angle on the normal and an abnormal side. It is divided into three. First is grade 1, that is a Southwick angle of 0 to 30 degrees, and grade 2, that is a Southwick angle of 30 to 60 degrees, and grade 3 is defined as 60 to 90 and greater than 90. In clinical practice, a true lateral radiograph of the hip is preferred than a frog-leg lateral radiograph, because the risk of further displacement of the epiphysis when we are obtaining a radiographic examination. The first concern of the clinician is to prevent the further slipping of the epiphysis. Patient presenting with a chronic or a stable acute slip should be treated with screw fixation in situ using a single cannulated screw. The basis of acceptance of fixation in situ is the capacity for remodeling of the proximal femur. This is the radiograph is showing the remodeling after the screw fixation. In figure 1, we can see that figure 1 shows that initial filling showing that there is a grade 3 unstable SCFE. In the figure 1b, we can see that a screw is fixed. In grade 1c, it's a radiograph taken after 18 months showing remodeling. Although the degree may not be as complete as originally thought, long-term studies confirm that the outcome of a SCFE is correlated with the severity of the initial slip. There is degenerative arthritis is the predictable outcome in moderate and severe sleep. The assumption that restoration of the anatomy at the outset of treatment will reduce the incidence of degenerative arthritis has stimulated surgeons to seek a reliable solution. The manipulation of the acute unstable sleep and the use of corrective osteotomies in severe and sometimes moderate degree of sleep in both stable and unstable situation have their proponents. The main aim of the treatment is to minimize avascular necrosis and chondrolysis. The primary aim is to prevent further slipping of the epiphysis. In grade 1 and grade 2, a single screw is the optimal treatment. For a stable sleep, there will not be any improvement in the position of the head is achieved. For unstable hip, there is an opportunity to realign the anatomy of the proximal femur. And Phillips and coworkers reviewed 100 cases and noted that 14 acute slips, all of which were reduced on the operating table. In that study, there was no cases of avascular necrosis were seen and the technique of gentle reposition was advocated. There is agreement among those who support the reduction of the acute slip that the patient should be positioned on the operating table with care. It ensures that there is gentle traction is applied and there should not be any forceful maneuver should be used when we are attempting a reposition. The ideal position for a limb is the internal rotation of 15 to 20 degree and an abduction of 20 to 30 degrees. Coming to the timing of intervention, acute reduction in Phillips and coworkers study was done in less than 24 hours. The Peterson and coworkers found that 91 acute slips, the rate of avascular necrosis was 7% for the reductions that performed less than 24 hours and 20% if the reduction is obtained after 24 hours. In Lauder study, the avascular necrosis happened for 32% of the patients who were treated after 48 hours of the onset of symptoms. But the Lauder and Corwalkers has said that the true cause and effect between the timing of intervention and development of avascular necrosis cannot be determined. So in acute sleep, the epiphyseal blood supply is king. In case of an unstable or acute or an acute on chronic sleep, the reduction will relieve the kinging, hence the blood flow will be restored. The preoperative bone scanning is a good predictor of ischemia. In an unstable SCIFI, in a study group of 10, bone scan of 6 of them showed ischemia. That 6 of them on later examination showed avascular necrosis. At the same time, out of the 4 without ischemia in the scans, they didn't show any kind of avascular necrosis later. For in the case of chronic cases, the gradual adaptation of the vasculature and maintenance of the blood supply to the caput happens. The rate of displacement is uncertain for chronic cases. The displacement pattern is like it is a stepwise progression than a continual smooth process. So this stepwise progression explains the on symptoms, that is intermittent symptoms can be seen in such patients for chronic cases. It also explains the longevity of the history and the delay in presentation. Small progressive slips may or may not be sufficient to compromise the blood flow to the epiphysis. A small reduction may result spontaneously with no permanent damage to the bone. Hence, there will not be any avascular necrosis. For a case of severe morphological displacement, correction of the deformity can be achieved by only osteotomies. Osteotomy close to the physis allows greater anatomical realignment and hence reduces the risk of degeneration and improves the hip function. But there will be high risk of avascular necrosis and chondrolysis. So as a conclusion, we can say that more the osteotomy distance, less will be the beneficiality and less will be the complication. In the case of Fish and Dunn study, they stated that the accidental there will be an accidental trauma detaches the head of the head and the tear, and it will tear the synovium from the back of the neck. In fish osteotomies, complete removal of the physis from metaphysis and epiphysis happens. This will allow bone-to-bone apposition, which increases union and revascularization. Hence, the head flow, blood supply to the head is restored. An osteotomy is contraindicated if the physis is closed. This is the diagram showing the fish cuneiform osteotomy in first two figures, that is figure 2a and 2b, shows the skiffy grade 3 of APL lateral view. In the figure 2c and 2d, we can see that a screw is inserted. After the cuneiform osteotomy and screw fixation, an AP filling was taken after 18 months, showing complete union with no avascular necrosis. But the presence of coxa brava is persisting. So in the case of avascular necrosis, in fishes, cuneiform osteotomy, we can see 4.5% of avascular necrosis. In the case of Nishiyam and Satamaki studies, there will be 5.5% of avascular necrosis. For other studies, there will be 35% of avascular necrosis. Next complication is chondrolysis. Chondrolysis can be seen in 10-30% of the cases, but chondrolysis is not isolated and it can be seen along with the avascular necrosis. Hence, the higher rates of complication can makes this procedure less favorable to the patient. Lauder noted that the natural history of chronic skiffy is favorable if the displacement is mild and a risk of 5% development of avascular necrosis is acceptable. But greater than 10% is not acceptable, and 5-10% is controversial. Alternative to osteotomy, we can attempt for a realignment of femur, and should be done more distally at the base of the neck or at the region of trochanteric region. The risk of avascular necrosis is less in this procedure, but the correction is less and it will be sounding only less biomechanically. The procedure can be performed at the time of presentation or later if the slip is filled in situ initially. The second approach allows observation of remodeling. The insertion of a pin is challenging with a greater degree of displacement, and it requires knowledge of pathoanatomy for the secure anterior placement of the screw. The area of contact between the epiphysis and the neck of femur decreases significantly with the greater slip, and the risk of penetration of pin with the vascular injury increases. So for severe slip, it is reasonable to do a cuneiform osteotomy. This is a diagram which showing the alignment. In the first figure 3a, we can see that the epiphyse and metaphysis is aligned correctly, and there will be only mild slip. So there will be a wide cross-sectional area of contact. In the case of in figure 3b, we can see that there is less amount of area of contact as in the case of a severe slip. And there will be considerably less area of contact, making the encroachment of the screw very likely. So this is a conclusion of a treatment of a skiffy. If the patient, first of all, we have to classify the patient as stable and unstable. Stable means the patient can bear weight. Unstable means the patient cannot bear the weight. If the after classifying stable and unstable, we have to get according to Southwick classification. If the skiffy is stable and it is grade 1 and 2, we can attempt for a screw fixation. And if the patient is stable and grade 3, we have to go for a screw fixation and a neck osteotomy. For an unstable patient, the onset of symptoms should be considered. If the patient is having less than 24 hours of onset of symptoms, irrespective of the grade, that is grade 1 and 2 and 3, should be attempted for a repositioning. After repositioning, we have to assess for the grade again. If the patient is having grade 1 and 2, we can attempt for a in situ pinning, that is screw fixation. For a grade 3 patient, the screw fixation or a neck osteotomy can be attempted. For an unstable patient, again we have to classify the patient as grade 1, 2 and 3. For a grade 1 and 2 patients, we can attempt for a screw fixation. For a grade 3 patient having an unstable hip, we should be waiting for 3 weeks under skin traction. Probably we can using a above knee skin traction. Then we have to reassess the patient. If the patient still have a grade 3, then we have to go for a screw fixation or a neck osteotomy. If the patient is having a decrease in grades, that is, if the patient is changing from grade 3 to grade 1 and 2, we have to go for screw fixation. And from this study, we can conclude that the management of skiffy is an area of controversy, since the true etiology is not yet confirmed, the treatment still produces considerable complication for some patients. Screw fixation is accepted procedure in most cases, but the less common unstable or severe slip produces more problem. surgeon must decide whether to fix all cases with a single screw and osteotomize secondarily. Those which fails to remodel or correct the deformity from the outset, accepting a high risk of potentially devastating complications, that is avascular necrosis and chondrolysis. An awareness of the time from the onset of symptoms is vital in helping to reduce the risk of treatment.
Okay, can you go back to the chart? Sometimes the examiner may be confusing you with a lot of questions. Then you can answer based on this chart. So this paper is a very famous paper, Uglu and Park. It is otherwise called Southampton Experience. Basically, the last one, that is unstable slip coming after 24 hours, which is grade 3. They advise to wait for 3 weeks. If the patient is having an acute slip, you have to do something quickly. Whether you want to reposition it or not, gentle reposition is needed or not, is based on whether it is stable or unstable. If the patient is not able to bear weight, so you should consider repositioning if the patient is coming to you within 24 hours. Okay, if the patient is not coming within 24 hours, no repositioning may be attempted, because that may not be helpful. You do in situ screw fixation. The screw you select is also important, because most of the articles recommend a fully threaded 6.5 mm cannulated screw. Whether it is cortical or cancerous is debatable. Cortical will be having less proud threads, so that may be more easily removed and less damaging to the physis. So fully threaded cortical screw may be an option, but it is not easily available. So what is available is a 6.5 fully threaded cannulated cancer screw. If it is a partially threaded one, if it is not reverse cutting, it may not be easy to remove the screw later on. Okay. Gentle repositioning means you position the child on the fracture table with slight abduction, and you just make the patella look upwards, so with some internal rotation. No other a slight traction is also given, so no other manipulation is attempted. That is called gentle repositioning.
I think the article is self-explanatory. It is a very good guideline for deciding on the treatment protocol. Nothing more to be added. We have already discussed the last time in part.
It is just a continuation of the previous presentation.
Yeah.
Only thing is that the previous discussion, there was a small confusion regarding the measurement of the Southwick ankle. It is actually a difference from the opposite side. You assume that the opposite side is normal. If it is not normal, you have to take a normal ankle. You subtract it from the normal side, and that is the ankle. Can you go back to the description of the Southwick ankle? So can you read that again? It is the difference between the head shaft angle on the normal and abnormal side. Okay. So suppose it is a bilateral slip, what will you do? You have to assume a normal ankle. So in AP it is assumed as 145, in lateral it is assumed as 120 degrees. Okay, so it is the difference from the opposite side. The examiner may sometimes ask this. If you are not aware of this, you may get into trouble. This measurement is important, because you decide on your treatment based on all three concepts. That is, whether it is stable or not, whether the child is able to bear weight or not, then whether it is acute or not, that is less than 24 hours, more than 24 hours. Now you can read Tashian. There is a very good description of slip in Tashian. Everything regarding slip is being explained in a very lucid manner. Regarding the pathology, etiology, diagnosis, how you take the measurements, what is their experience. everything is written very beautifully. So you can make your own notes. And SLIP is usually a commonly asked question, both theory and practicals. You should not miss it.